Thank you very much for having me here. Thank you, Andras and Kinga, for organizing the conference. Indeed, as several of my previous speakers have said, it's kind of the expectation grows if you know you're going to go there and speak, and then another year passes and you can't. And if we only look at the way we would have talked a year ago and the way we talk now, you will see in my very first slide in a moment, things have changed quite significantly. And you will immediately know what I mean. The second point is I have to excuse myself for not being here yesterday, actually more to myself, because I really fear I missed a lot. Already hearing the diversity of the presentations today, I was speaking at a conference that I organized myself in Munich yesterday about media and media regulation. So basically, very similar to what I will be talking about now. But what I tried to do at the airport, and technology has advanced greatly, but it wasn't enough for that. I tried to download the video recording of yesterday to watch it at least in parts in the plane, but the Wi-Fi didn't accept me to do that because it was just too long and too many thoughts maybe in it. So what I did is in the hotel, but it was very light. I arrived very late at night, so I did a fast forward through the presentations yesterday. And I do know you've been talking a little bit already about the setting of the platform economy. I'm not an economist, but the title of my presentation is After the Rise of the Platform Economy. So basically, after the platforms became bigger, too big, I don't know. We now have the rise of platform regulation, question mark. That's what I would like to talk about. I will try to give a first evaluation of what we're seeing on the level of the European Union, and I will briefly at the end also draw attention to the Council of Europe, which is very often overlooked in this context. As I told you, the first slide, and David in a way took away my pun, yesterday night I saw I have a good way to start this. I'm never sure about these new names. You know, when Google mother company decided to call themselves Alphabet, I thought, that's quite bold. We are the new Alphabet. If you create a company that has had a lot of problems in the past couple of months or maybe years, and then you call it Meta, this invites us to say we really have a Meta problem potentially with that, don't we? And it's not coincidental that it's blue. What do I mean with we have a Meta problem? We have a problem, and this is what this conference is about, on how to regulate a factual new situation, and that is the dominance of content and speech dissemination online. Whether we like it or not, it's there. And the question is, how do we regulate? And we heard in many of the presentations, the platform society is a bit different. The platform economy is a bit different to what we had. So the question is, what regulatory approach is the right answer? And in order to do that, we have to go a little bit back into history, at least if we look at the European level. So forgive me that I do a little bit of history, but you will understand hopefully why I'm doing that. I have, over the last couple of years, developed in a lot of presentations I've been giving this idea of a flower. Of a flower of regulation of the media through European legislative acts. I have to be very careful, that's why it's in quotation marks, because media regulation, as such, is not within the competence of the European Union, at least not as such. It's still in the realm of the member states. So, all of the laws that we talk about, except for one, don't really address the media as a full rule set on the European Union level. And when we talk about regulating content dissemination, a lot of the laws I will be talking about on the European Union level are not labeled free speech or online speech regulation, but they impact the sector. And that's why a flower is maybe a good picture, because it has a lot of different elements to it. Some people say flowers are very beautiful, so it has a kind of a optimistic, positive connotation. But what I want to show is that it has several elements, like any flower, like a sunflower that has several leaves around it. And the one exception that is full spot-on media regulation on the European level is the Audiovisual Media Services Directive. For those of you who are interested in history, 1989, so a little more than three decades ago, the European Union says, television signals cross borders, whether you like it or not. So let's create an internal market directive, the Television Without Frontiers Directive. That's the official title. It says exactly what it's about. Allow providers to offer television signals that cross borders. To take it from a free speech perspective, that also means people can inform themselves from sources that come from outside of their national borders. So there's both elements in there. Economy, the ones that want to offer on a bigger market their signal, but also the element of free speech. And that developed further into the Audiovisual Media Services Directive when it was reformed to reflect that now we don't anymore only have television, but audiovisual media services. And it was most recently reformed in 2018, so still relatively fresh. Most member states are well beyond the transposition deadline, but still haven't transposed. And why is it irrelevant? Because in that last reform, 2018, and I guess yesterday, at least in two presentations in my fast forward, I saw it was mentioned, so-called video sharing platforms have been included into the regulation. Not as much as TV and on-demand services, but at least video sharing platforms are regarded as an important element of content dissemination and therefore have to, for example, respect certain basic rules on how to avoid the proliferation, for example, of hate speech online. We have heard in several presentations the role of copyright. Copyright is not media, but obviously you cannot do content dissemination without thinking about copyright rules. And it's interesting because some of, and we just heard that a few moments ago, some of the rules that I will be talking about have been developed in the copyright context. Actually, most of the behavior of the platforms stems from reactions to copyright, potential copyright violations. Why? Because that's where the money is. If as a platform you're held liable for a copyright violation, that's very costly. If you're held liable, okay, I just get the signal, sorry for that. I forgot it's being interpreted. I should have first reminded myself with interpreters, I have to be a bit slower. You signal again if it gets too fast, okay? Sorry. So copyright is not only where it is expensive, it hurts the companies potentially more, the companies, not the society, than, for example, if content like hate speech is disseminated. Because who brings a case against hate speech to court? And over even a case of problems at the workplace is not as costly as if you're held liable for leaking the new James Bond movie before it comes to the cinema. That can be very costly and it can kill your business, which is why a lot of the internal actions of platforms actually were reactions to copyright violations or do something against potential copyright violations. So that's why we have to look at copyright law. We have heard as well that So maybe I should give you some examples to explain why I'm looking in this field. And I'm not going to go in any details. I'm not the copyright lawyer today, but just look at the dates of the regulations that I'm putting out there. Portability regulation concerns cross-border access to online content, 2017. Online SATCAP directive, a very important extension of the rules to the online sphere that existed previously for cable and satellite dissemination, 2019. Look at the DSM copyright directive that we heard about a lot yesterday and today, 2019, still in the process of being transposed in the member states. So very, very current developments. Data protection was mentioned before. The GDPR, we're not allowed to forget, it is from 2016, but it only became applicable in 2018. So still a relatively new piece of regulation. The connection to the online sphere is obvious. My colleagues have talked about it. I don't need to do that. But we don't only have the GDPR. We also have the e-privacy rules, which are clearly oriented at communication that happens, or data protection rules that relate to communication. And there we have at the moment a directive which is supposed to be replaced by a regulation on the European Union level. And that has still not happened. It's delayed since a couple of years. And it's supposed to align the online data protection rules with the GDPR rules. We have further, I think the battery is beginning to get old. We have further rules in the area of data protection that also play a role in the context of online platforms. For example, the free flow of non-personal data regulation. And all of this shows that a lot of what afterwards I will call the online content dissemination regulatory framework relates to other fields, IP law, data protection law, or telecommunications law. The European Union completely reformed its telecommunications legal framework in 2018 with the need to transpose by the end of December last year. Again, most member states have not yet fully transposed the new so-called Electronic Communications Code, which contains rules that are applicable to online platforms. And then obviously, and this is where we come into the core of what I'm going to present, we've got the rules concerning electronic commerce, the e-commerce. Andras, in his opening presentation yesterday, pointed out that the e-commerce directive exists since 2000. You could also turn it negatively, and you can say it's been out there since the year 2000 and never been changed. Just in case you want to imagine what the internet was like in the year 2000, there are a lot of sources on the internet that you can find it. From my own experience, in those days, if you wanted to access a website, what you did is you typed it into your browser, which was something completely different than the browsers of today, and then you would go in the kitchen and make a coffee. And if you were lucky when you came back with the coffee, the website had finally set itself up. And there was no moving images and no pictures on that. It was just text. And so we have a regulatory framework for the online sector built to allow innovation of the platform economy, which nobody knew that it was going to be the platform economy, which is completely different to the world of Alphabet, Meta, and all the others. Just to keep that in mind. However, it's not that nothing has happened in the last 20 years concerning the regulatory framework online. We do have attempts at dealing with the online platforms, even concerning their role as online platforms, and not in all of the other flower elements that I just mentioned. First, the European Union, the European Commission, proposed not to regulate by hard law, but they issued communications, recommendations on how to deal with certain negative aspects in the online context. So, for example, we have a communication on the removal of illegal content online. A couple of years old, and it basically asked the industry to find solutions themselves, self-regulation, on how to deal with illegal content on their platforms. That's important because it is the first step to what will become the DSA. So you start out with soft law, and if it doesn't work very well, you add hard law, real rules. Another one is, and it's often overlooked, quite early there was a recommendation how to deal with disinformation, and based on that, the industry agreed on a code of practice. I think many of you will be aware that this code of practice on disinformation is regarded as not being sufficient. The Commission has done an evaluation and has requested that the industry updates this code of practice that is just ongoing, and my guess is that in relatively short period of time, we will also see hard law concerning disinformation, at least in the context of elections, of political decision making. And we have seen hard law developing in the last 1 or 2 years in the field of online platforms mixed with e-commerce, and one is, mentioned this morning, the platform to business regulation. That is very often overlooked. Why? Because the title suggests that it has a very narrow application field. How businesses can ask platforms to explain to them certain things, rankings were mentioned, there has to be a transparency about the selection criteria for businesses that rely on platforms, not for the end user. But the reality is that's the role model of what we will see in the Digital Markets Act, at least in parts. And that became applicable last year in July. So a really, really new piece of law. And then one thing that whenever you look at European law, you're not allowed to forget at all and ever is the role of the Court of Justice of the European Union. I just say data protection and SREMS, and you will maybe know what I mean, how fundamentally interpretations by the Court of Justice of the European Union can shape the actual meaning of all of these pieces of legislation that I mean. And you will see afterwards in the area of the online platforms, this has been the case already in the past, for example, with the Uber decision or the Airbnb decision of the Court of Justice. So this is already a relatively complex flower. The Court of Justice, as I said, is maybe the most important driver when it comes to furthering existing law, but now we want to look at how the law is going to be developed by the Commission, the Parliament, and the Council in the near future. And that we're going to do by adding another layer of complexity. This is specific law, either for the media or that relates to online platforms. But there is more. And that is very important, again, to understand the genesis of the Digital Services Act proposal and the Digital Markets Act proposal. And that is all of this, there's like another layer in the flower. You're not allowed to forget that we also have competition law. And competition law has been a key driver to regulate, quote unquote, because it's not real regulation, of the online market. We have several major antitrust cases against Google, for example. And because there is the perception that these antitrust cases are not sufficient, they're not fast enough, they're only individual cases that can be dealt with, that's the reason why we get the DMA. Because the DMA is not specific for individual cases, but puts the obligation on platforms to basically behave in a way that is in line with competition law. But from an ex-ante perspective and not after something like an abuse of dominant market position has taken place. We also have, by the way, but that's more a side note, we also have another area of competition law, and that is state aid. Quite important when it comes to financing, for example, public service sector media, so public service broadcasting. Why is that important in the online sector? There has been a quite strong move in the last years to say we need more digital sovereignty in Europe. And more digital sovereignty in Europe ideally would mean European platforms. I don't think a European platform will ever come into existence if it is not pushed and supported by some form of public means. So maybe in 10 years we have a conference and we'll be discussing the public service online platform. And then we are in the question, is that okay with state aid rules by the European Union? And then another area that often is overlooked is consumer protection law, which is not specific for media, it's not specific for online, but you will see that there has been development of the consumer protection law with a direct effect for the online area. I will give you one example in a moment. So, a lot of complexity. Normally at this point we would have to take a pause to digest this, but in view of the time I have to move on directly, and I just want to very quickly show you in a few bullets the timeline on that before then looking at the future. So, the Audiovisual Media Services Directive for me is always a nice example. 1989, it was revised every 10 years, so all of those bullets are a revision. General Data Protection Regulation is the first change of the data protection framework since 1995, so two decades. E-commerce Directive until today, no change, two decades. So it's overdue by European Union standards. Copyright. The major directive before the DSM directive was 2001, so again, nearly two decades. The big question is, what is going to happen with this e-commerce directive? Is it going to be replaced by the DSA? No. Is it going to be supplemented by the DSA? That's the plan at the moment. Is that enough? Is that sufficient? So question mark here, because we don't know that yet. One other area I want to just reinforce, the recommendation that I mentioned before is of 2018. If you read it, and then you read the DSA, then you can see that there are a lot of the issues of that recommendation were simply copy-pasted into the DSA proposal. So, platform-to-business regulation, very short history, and the next thing that I have not mentioned until now is the terrorist content online regulation, which also will feed into the DSA. I will come back to that in a moment. So, we have had indications of what I would call a wind of change concerning how the online area is going to be regulated in a more broader sense. Just as a highlight, once again, because you heard about that, DSM directive introduced a new category, online content sharing service providers. Okay, clearly online platforms. And they have new obligations. The GDPR concerns not only platforms, but also platforms and the way they process data. And the GDPR is a role model for what is coming next because it introduced technical rules into a set of law, so a little bit, the code as law idea of Lawrence Lessig, and it took a transnational approach. We don't care where the companies sit, is, whether within or without the European Union, if they offer services to EU citizens, they have to abide by the law of the GDPR. The platform to business regulation is very important, and I'm very grateful that you mentioned it several times, because it is still an overlooked piece of legislation. It is quite far-reaching in terms of the obligations of platforms. So it shouldn't come as a total surprise to them that in future they might also have similar obligations towards the end user. This terrorist content online regulation, it doesn't concern the terrorist content online, it concerns the removal of the terrorist content online, is a reaction to the idea that dealing with illegal speech online is not efficient enough yet. And so in the wake of some of the terrorist attacks in the last years, there was a push that the European Union does something specifically for this type of content. So we have a rule set, very simplified, that says concerning terrorist propaganda, platforms have, after all, proactive measures to take. They have to react, they have to have systems in place that allow them to react very fast, in some instances within an hour, to take down content. Only a specific type of content, terrorist propaganda, but if that is possible, the next question is, couldn't that also be applied, for example, for normal hate speech or for other types of problematic content? That's why we're not allowed to overlook this either. And then, but that is something I don't want to go into, we also have a lot of soft law, so additional measures from the European Union how to tackle certain issues on the in the platform sector. Let's return to the flower. Are we on the way to a future regulatory framework for online content dissemination? My argument is yes, because besides all of the issues that we have, which I will just differentiate by black and red font, a lot of what is red on here are issues which have been changed or are in the scope of being changed at the very moment in the last 1 or 2 years or in the forthcoming 1 or 2 years. So already that is, if you try to keep an overview, a lot of elements that have been added or changed only in the very recent time. And again, even the AVMSD, which is 3 years old, is still not transposed in all the member states. Being a directive has to be transposed. In the area of online platforms, that's the only area that I want to highlight. The Commission has clearly announced that they are going to take care of the disinformation situation more strictly. That was in July 2021. And in the State of the Union address of Ursula von der Leyen in September 2021, so a few weeks ago, I couldn't have talked about that last year because it was totally inexistent, that idea, but now it's there. She has announced that the European Union, the Commission will propose a European Media Freedom Act in the third quarter of next year. I will talk about that in my final slides, what we might have to expect from there. The application of the platform to business regulation is only just happening. We are only getting the first cases where companies are saying, explain to me why I am not on ranking position one, or why I am not in the headline bullets at the beginning of the Google search engine. And I told you that consumer protection is very important. If you look at that regulation of 2019, transparency obligations that are very similarly contained in the platform to business regulation are here extended to the relation between platforms and end users, now from a perspective of consumer protection. So also as a consumer, you have certain rights vis-a-vis the platforms, at least if it has been transposed already, the directive, in order to find out why, for example, certain type of content is not listed. And we are still in a process of learning how this will impact the online sector. And this terrorist content online regulation was heavily, heavily attacked, especially in the European Parliament, because many said this is opening Pandora's box. If you request platforms to take down content within an hour, there is not much they can do in order to check whether the takedown request is really in line, for example, with fundamental rights aspects. I'm not going to talk about that because I think OS later will have a little bit of the ideas of fundamental rights in there. And I mentioned Uber, Airbnb. It's got nothing to do with speech. But you have to look at those decisions of the Court of Justice to understand how the platform economy is characterized also by the court, because that will impact the future application, in my view, also of the new framework that we're getting. So the complexity is big enough, but now comes the big surprise. Last December, the Commission says, here is our package, the Digital Services Act package, with which we want to tackle the online sector in the future. Two main elements, the Digital Services Act, proposed mid-December, and the Digital Markets Act of the same day. We're in the midst of a very controversial positioning of both the member states. This week, I have heard 2 days ago that the Council seems to have found more or less an agreement on their position on how they're going to go into the negotiations with the Parliament. In 2 or 3 weeks, I think the formal vote is supposed to take place. We don't know when it will come into place and what exactly the shape will be. The Parliament, for example, has very different ideas what should be in the DSA. But my guess is within 2 years from now, we will have two pieces of legislation, and both of them are in the form of a regulation. So we do not have the time lag that we have, for example, with the AVMSD, with the transposition. So we have a certain centralization or harmonization on the European level of how to deal with platforms. But then we also have a proposal on the table for AI regulation. Not going to talk about that, it would lead too far. But also that should be looked at when we talk about platform regulation. And then we have this ominous Media Freedom Act announced for the third quarter of 2022. Let's see what is going to be in there. I will give one first evaluation on that in a moment. So I'm sorry to say, but this is a really complex flower, right? You have to be a botanic expert to interpret that. And why am I saying this? Not because it's just, you know, nice to have this design. It's to show that it's becoming more and more difficult to understand whether or not there is going to be a consistency on how to approach this. I'm not suggesting that it would be possible to replace all of this with one act, you know, that is horizontally applicable to the online sector. Not at all. But it's becoming increasingly complicated to make sure. How do we deal with overlaps? How do we avoid inconsistencies? And this is only the European level. Don't forget, every directive has a national transposition, which means we have 27 national transpositions. And there is always the question, is the European Union really competent to deal with all of these issues? So the complexity is not getting smaller. Let's look at a little bit more, just a little bit more in detail on those four new abbreviations that you should know, the EDAP, the DSA, the DMA, and the EMFA or MFA. So EDAP is the European Democracy Action Plan. Not hard law, but in the European Democracy Action Plan, the Commission has announced measures on promoting free and fair elections. Why is it relevant in the online platform regulation sector? Because it deals with political advertising. Where does political advertising take place today? Where are the campaigns rolled out? Not anymore mainly on billboards and TV. They are mainly rolled out on social media. It's also about protection of journalists and journalistic standards. Now, that's the heart of media, right? And didn't I say at the beginning, media regulation is something that is more in member state level? Indeed. There is a recommendation of the European Commission from September 2021, again, a few weeks ago. So, Andras, perfect timing for the conference and the delay of the conference, because we can mention this. A recommendation of the European Union on how member states should better protect the work of journalists, which is great in principle, so it also meets my support. But again, the question is this the first step to some form of regulation of the media sector by the European Union? And if so, is that possible? And it includes a section on how to combat disinformation, again, mainly in connection with elections. DMA, you heard about that a little bit, just as a reminder. There will be specific, if it comes as it's planned, there will be specific obligations and also prohibitions, sorry for the typo, for online gatekeepers. So for very few companies which have a very powerful position, so-called gatekeepers, and which offer so-called core platform services. So for a few types of services which are absolutely relevant for other businesses to reach their users, and if you have a certain size, in future you have to respect a quite long list of obligations and certain behaviors are going to be prohibited. Interesting for me is, as a media lawyer, looking at that situation, the supervision of this whole field is supposed to be centralized into the Commission's hands. Why? Big platforms need one-stop shop. They need one person or one institution to address. Which institution could that be? The European Commission. You know, we look around and we don't find another. In the area of competition law, that's exactly the same situation. But in the area of competition law, we have clear application of economic-driven competition criteria. In this area of the DMA, it's going to be more. It's going to be about fairness between how the users can or cannot profit from the services of such gatekeepers. And it goes, for me, beyond pure competition law. And then the question is a executive body really the perfect place to centralize all of it? This, even more important, is that question if we look at the Digital Services Act. Also there is rules proposed on the structure and the cooperation of the existing supervisory authorities. There are new things created, such as digital services coordinators, which could be existing national authorities, but could also be new ones. We discussed that on the way here. Who is going to be the future overlook institution when it comes to online also content dissemination? We as media lawyers would say, well, the media regulator is well placed. Other member states might say, well, the online sector is so closely related to markets questions, let's let the cartel authority do that. Cartel authorities have never balanced free speech against anything else. They've just looked at market power. So there's a real problem here. Why? Because the DSA attempts at reforming the liability rules for platforms, I put in brackets, or not. Why? Because it actually leaves the liability regime more or less untouched. Again, we've heard that in other speeches, so I don't have to repeat that. Interesting is only the following. Certain types of online platforms will be confronted with additional obligations. Not liability, but additional obligations that they have to respect. For example, when it comes to how they moderate content. It's going to be differentiated by the size of the companies. You probably heard this funny expression of the VLOPs, the very large online platforms, the VLOPs, which will have much more obligations than a regular online platform. So there's a lot going to be in that Digital Services Act, but I want to focus once more on the European Media Freedom Act. Nobody knows exactly what is going to be in there because the public consultation will only start in a few weeks. Please, if you're interested in this sector, look at it when it comes. Because I can only tell you the following, and it's not secret because, well, maybe it is, I don't know, but the Commission has been looking into the matter of independence and freedom of the media by conducting certain academic studies. And it's always interesting to look at what are we academic experts asked to reflect about, because then you know what might come out of it at the end. And I can share with you that there is ongoing studies which deal with such interesting questions. For example, the governance structures of public service media. Now, public service media, clearly competence of the member states. The question of what type of governance models exist might be an indication that in the European Media Freedom Act, we will also hear something about that. Another area, and I will leave it at those two, will be what role do media councils play in the balancing of rights? Media councils, you know, like in the press, a lot of press councils, self-regulation, and I think the idea is whether the Facebook oversight board type of model could be transporting this idea of press councils into the online world. Indicates again, maybe we will see that in the proposal for a European Media Freedom Act. I'm a little bit over time, so I will just very, very briefly highlight one other area, and that is the Council of Europe. So we're moving away from Brussels for a moment, and we're going to Strasbourg. And I'm going to do that, I'm going to self-advertise, I'm going to self-promote a little bit, if you forgive, but I'm not doing it because it's me, but because I believe in the work of the Council of Europe. The Council of Europe is an area that you should look into, or an organization you should look into if you're interested in online platform regulation. They have been developing standards, not binding law. The Council of Europe cannot create binding law, but standards for how to deal, for example, with big data processing on platforms, media, a lot of standards, for example, public service media governance standards. We even have already a quite voluminous and interesting document on how to deal with artificial intelligence, and it's going to be turned into a convention. So there will be an offer to the member states of the Council of Europe next year to create a, to sign and ratify a convention on how to regulate artificial intelligence. And more specifically, and that's why I'm saying self-promotion, but really not because of me as a person, I had the pleasure to work with colleagues in the Committee of Experts on Media Environment and Reform with this very odd abbreviation, MSIREF. And a few weeks ago, we have concluded our work on the following document. We had several documents that we had to work on. One of them, where I was the co-rapporteur, was a draft recommendation, which hopefully will eventually become a recommendation. We don't know yet what the member states think about it, which is addressed to member states on principles for media and communication governance. Maybe that is going to be the, or let's be a little bit more modest, a possible future benchmark for online regulation. Why? Because we have developed a set of 5 procedural and 10 substantive principles, which should guide every state when it creates the regulatory framework for media and communication, and that clearly means the second pillar, the online communication. Procedural means how to create the laws, for example, an inclusive way, asking also society what they expect in terms of regulation, and substantive means what rules should be in that law. When we designed that, we acknowledged the roles that platforms have in today's content dissemination in aligning some elements of media law and platform regulation law. So trying to create this coherence between the different fields to a certain extent. We still acknowledge that there are also differences between platforms and traditional media. Obviously, they are not editorial content managed. And we also acknowledge that there are different roles of the states. They create the regulatory framework, the media, the platforms, and also the users in this new platform reality. If you want to know more about it, here you can find the draft text. It's already gone through public consultation and will be discussed in the responsible committee at the beginning of December. And if everything goes well, next March, it will be out as a recommendation. And I think there is a lot of food for thought in there. And finally, because I could not cover everything that I would like to say about the DSA and the DMA, I've done with my institute 2 studies on what's the deficiencies of the current e-commerce framework, but more importantly, what do we think of the DSA proposal? So that second book has just come out a few months ago, and if you want to, it's freely available at the publisher website. The slides will be made available, so if you click on those links, you will get the full text, the extensive overview of what I think. Thank you very much for your attention.